Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning, Pastor.
Welcome to worship today. It's Holy Trinity Sunday in the church, which is usually the Sunday after the Sunday of Pentecost, the very beginning of our journey through those long weeks of growing season. Next week, the altar will be green until the last Sunday in October. And so that's the season of Pentecost, where just like the crops are growing outside, through the teachings of the scriptures, the church grows spiritually. And so we're grateful to be starting that adventure today with the Holy Trinity. An important day because oftentimes people just substitute the word God and they mean all sorts of different things when they say God. But the scriptures are pretty specific about who God is and what God ought to be named and what the parts of God do. So we'll not only hear that from the scriptures, but also today as we confess our faith. Both of the creeds are based on the teaching of the early church and the apostles, and so that is still the way that we refer to God as the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We have church council this morning at 11:15, so we'll be back for that. And otherwise, the only other thing it's not on the calendar on the back of the bulletin, but maybe you've seen these around. There is a group here in town. They've received a grant from the Prairie Lakes Art Council, and it is for a concert series during the summer. So there are going to be three concerts in town. One of them is this afternoon, the first of them. It'll be from 3:30 to 5, hopefully in the city park, but if it's raining, then just divert over to Trinity, and it will be there. It's the Benson Family Singers, and some of you know them, I think. It's a gospel bluegrass group. Peter Benson, I guess, grew up here. And so they'll be performing this afternoon, and then a couple other dates, you'll see new posters around town. But grateful for this grant that they've given us to have concerts here in town. I think they're at the Care Center before that too, aren't they? Yeah, that part of the grant was that Care Center will get to enjoy good music as well. So that's coming up this afternoon if you've got some time. 3:30, either in the city park or at Trinity, and then afterwards there's, the Willows food truck is going. Oh, the food truck will be there the whole time, so you can start eating at 3:30 if you so choose, which some of us might. That'll be a good afternoon. Hopefully the weather holds. I think that is all of the announcements for today. There is coffee downstairs afterwards. Thank you to Bethke's for putting that on. There is a sign-up sheet on the table down there. Always looking for people to take the following week. So if you've got time for next Sunday, we're doing, I think last week we got 4 dozen donut holes. I might have bought 5 if I did it again. 30 cups of coffee, pretty simple to do, but it's also nice when folks do that. So sign up if you can, join us for coffee after worship. All of our songs today, of course, will revolve around the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As we enter into worship, let's begin with number 535. Holy God, we praise your name.
Thank you. called, gathered, enlightened, and sanctified by the Holy Spirit of God. We worship this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us come humbly before God and our brothers and sisters in the faith, confessing our sins, known and unknown, trusting in God's gracious word of forgiveness. Holy God, who brings life out of death and transforms the whole creation with a word, forgive our disobedience and breathe on us the spirit of your righteousness. Free us from the power of sin, death, and the devil in our lives. Renew us with your loving spirit as you bring us from death to sin to life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Make us your instruments of peace and love in the world, and free us from all that seeks to enslave us, trusting that your will for us is that we would be free to live fully into your mercy and grace. Amen. It is by the command and authority of Christ that I declare to you this morning the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, who grants us life eternal.
The glory of the Father, who created us in love, and the power of the Holy Spirit, who forgives and renews our life, be with you all. Thank you. Together we pray. Majestic Trinity, mystery of three in one, and one in three, we worship you.
Before time, your love burst forth, creating the world in which you took delight. Strengthen us in our faith, defend us from all evil and temptation, and bring us into the everlasting presence of your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. In our gospel lesson today, the religious teachers, the Jewish teachers of Jesus' day, didn't understand his eternal nature. They were offended when he spoke about his relationship with God, his Father. Before the world was created, Jesus, the divine word and divine wisdom, existed. He existed even before Abraham and before the people of Israel. Such words caused the religious leaders to pick up stones to try and kill Jesus. But to all of their protests, Jesus continues to say, "I am." Our first reading today comes from Proverbs chapter 8. If you've ever ridden through the book of Proverbs, we eat Chinese food the other night, you know, and you crack open the fortune cookie, and on the backside there's a kind of a pithy little statement. They always get the nice ones, and mine's always like this impending word of doom on the back of mine, but usually they're pretty nice. But oftentimes there'll be wise sayings, and sometimes we look at the book of Proverbs like a collection of fortune cookie things, little isolated lines where King Solomon or King Hezekiah wrote a couple of them, where they think up some smart things and they write them down in a book, and now they've wound up in our Bible. And to be sure, there are wise sayings. All of them are wise sayings. But we don't want to miss this. In Proverbs chapter 8, wisdom actually begins to act like a person. It speaks. It's got personification, and wisdom says at the very beginning, "I was there with God." And so as we take time during the summer to find Jesus in the Old Testament readings in the book of Proverbs, here is Jesus before he is the Word in the flesh. Solomon writes, "Does not wisdom call? Does not understanding raise her voice? On the heights and beside the way, at the crossroads, she takes her stand. Besides the gates of the front of the town, at the entrance of the portal, she cries aloud. To you, O men, I call, and my cry is to the children of man." And then picking up at verse 22, "The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old. Ages ago, I was set up at the very first, at the beginning of the earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no springs abounding with water. Before the mountains had been shaped and before the hills, I was brought forth. Before he had made the earth with its fields or the first of the dust of the world. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, and when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned to the sea its limits so that the waters might not transgress his command, when he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him, like a master workman, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world, and delighting in the children of man. There ends our first lesson. Our psalm today, printed in the bulletin, is Psalm 8.
I have ordered a new microphone, by the way. I hope it gets here soon. It'll be the appropriate microphone for this unit. Psalm 8 today, printed in your bulletin. The psalmist here praises God for his creative power and asks, and maybe you've done this before, you go outside on a beautiful night and you see the stars of the heavens or you see something awesome and majestic and you might ask yourself, does God really know my name? Does he really care a thing about me? King David wondered the same thing. I'm sure as a shepherd, he spent many nights under the heavens. And one of the things David did know, because he was God's prophet as well as his king, was that God does delight not only in humanity in general, but in individuals as well. We feel insignificant in the face of it all, but God knows our name. And so together, we'll read aloud Psalm number 8. O Lord, our Lord, how exalted is your name in all the world. Out of the mouths of infants and children, your majesty is praised above the heavens. You have set up a stronghold against your adversaries to quell the enemy and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars you have set in their courses, what is man that you should be mindful of him? The son of man that you should seek him out? You have made him but a little lower than the angels. You adorn him with glory and honor. You give him mastery over the works of your hands. You put all things under his feet. All sheep and oxen, even the wild beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever walks in the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how exalted is your name in all the world. Our second lesson today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2. This is a continuation of Peter's sermon that he began last week on Pentecost Sunday. After the Holy Spirit had been given to the apostles on Pentecost, 50 days after the resurrection, Peter addresses
the gathered and explained who Jesus was, what he did, and how it was that God raised him from the dead. This Jesus that you crucified, Peter declared to the Jews, was the one that God sent to humanity to save us from sin and death, and he is the Lord of all. And so we continue. Verse 14 just resets his sermon from last week, and then we'll begin in earnest at verse 22. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and he addressed them. And we continue. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced, and my flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. And then Peter continued, Brothers, I say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this, that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. There ends our second lesson. If you are able, please rise for the reading of the gospel. Our holy gospel for this Holy Trinity Sunday comes from John chapter 8, beginning at verse 48. And the Jews answered Jesus, "Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and that you have a demon?" Jesus said, "I don't have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." Then the Jews said to him, "Now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets, and yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham who died, than the prophets who died? Who do you make yourself out to be?" Jesus answered, "If I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it, and he was glad." And so the Jews said to him, "You're not yet 50 years old, and you've seen Abraham?" Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." And they picked up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. The world, and increasingly the Christian church, is a melting pot of ideas when it comes to God. And since today we're talking about God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I will make an aside comment here. In the state of Minnesota recently, there have been church-wide conventions, or district conventions, whatever you want to call them, where the name Father, Son, and Holy Spirit was not uttered at one time. Instead, they will substitute other names for it. A melting pot of ideas. Oftentimes, the culture demands that the church teach about something in a certain way. And this is emblematic of our times. This isn't a brand new thing. Case in point, I want to point out a study, and this study is actually already 13 years old. It'd be interesting to know if they redid this study in 2022, if the numbers would change. But George Barna, he has a polling business where he usually operates in the realms of the church and interviews Christians. And so back in 2009, he did a study about the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and for good measure, Satan. Threw him in there to see what people, Christians' thoughts were about that. And so in that survey in 2009, he had interviewed 1,900 professing Christians. And this is some of the highlights of his study, especially that speak to Holy Trinity Sunday, I think. First of all, 55% of the Christians surveyed believe that the Bible is entirely accurate in what it teaches. You say, 55%, that's more than half. It is. But that also means there's 45% of these professing Christians will not place their faith in this book because it contains errors, because there is untruth in here. It's a pretty shocking number. Of those 1,900 Christians surveyed, 40% of them did not believe that Satan was a real entity. He's a literary figure. Maybe he's the bad side of human nature, but he wasn't, whatever it was, he was not a real existing figure. Almost a shocking 38% said they didn't believe the Holy Spirit was a real entity either. Even though in church on Sundays you confess, "I believe in God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit," they were saying, 38% of them, the Holy Spirit isn't really this real thing. 40% didn't believe Satan. The Bible teaches that's true. 38% didn't believe the Holy Spirit was real. The Bible teaches that he was real, is real. And here's the shocking one. Despite those earlier numbers, 64% of the people who were interviewed believed that you could be under the influence of spiritual forces, which don't really exist. When I talk about it being a melting pot, these numbers don't even line up with coherent thought amongst the 1,900 people that were surveyed. And just to round it off, as we talk about Jesus today, the third part of the Trinity, 22% of those that were interviewed believed that Jesus committed sins while he was a human being. And the Bible definitely does not teach that, even for a moment. Where do these ideas come from? It's a good question. I think the takeaway from this study is this, that even those who profess to be Christians don't actually know what this book says. This is the Word of God for us. This is, even in our Constitution, this is the sole source and authority. And yet we will find all sorts of other authorities that we'll listen to and even teach as truth without even opening the words of the Scriptures. I think a lot of our beliefs we make up on our own. Things that we want for ourselves, we imagine that God wants those for us as well. Maybe whatever the world is asking for, since we really want to be friends with them, we'll give them what they want and we'll change our teachings for them. I think we do that often without actually opening up the Scriptures and saying, "I wonder what the Scripture does say about dot, dot, dot," and you can put in almost any category in there. Oftentimes, we don't open up the Bible. We've just got some preconceived ideas, and we run with those. And now you know why I have begun pushing for people to read through the Bible in a year. You got to get your eyes on every word in this book, and I would say even on a yearly basis. The first year I read through the Scriptures and looked at every word of it, I was shocked at the things I had never seen before. I was embarrassed that I was a pastor who taught that the Bible was the Word of God, and I had never taken the time to actually read the whole thing. I will not continue to make that mistake, and I will encourage people not to do that as well. The more we ignore this book and start teaching other stuff about God, that's how you can get yourself a Christian assembly where Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are not even mentioned any longer. I think this is important why Holy Trinity Sunday is observed in the church. We talk about the Trinity every Sunday. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we confess the creed. Our prayers usually have a Trinitarian nature to them. But there needs to be one day where we stop and we put our foot down and say, God has revealed himself in this book as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And so today we do that. We not only hear some information from the Bible that this is how God has revealed himself, but it gives us the object of our worship. It reminds us what this God has done for his creation when we hold the Holy Trinity and we acknowledge and we worship him. So, let's go through the readings for this week. I don't know, any of you read the newsletter yet this month? One person. Thank you, Rick. Appreciate that. One of the most amazing newsletter articles ever written by a pastor is on the first page. There you go. Now you're going to run home and read it, I'm sure. But in that, one of the things that I've been thinking a lot lately, last couple of years, and I'm right now in the midst of reading a book about this, when Jesus, between his resurrection and the ascension, we've talked about this, that when we were on Ascension Sunday and Pentecost Sunday, it said, during those 40 days, Jesus sat down with his disciples. Why did Jesus hang around on earth for 40 days? I'm becoming more and more convinced, based on the words of Scripture, that Jesus was using that time to say, all right, disciples, now that you've seen everything from my baptism through my resurrection, I'm going to now teach you who I am and how I fulfilled the Old Testament. And so it says that Jesus opened up to them the Scriptures, which for them, it would be our Old Testament. For them, it was just the scriptures. And Jesus began to teach how all of them point to him. And so the newsletter article said, each Sunday during summer, I'm going to challenge myself to say, where in this Old Testament reading today are we going to find Jesus? And so we'll call it for the summer our Where's Waldo moment. Anybody like Waldo books? Raise your hand if you've ever heard of Where's Waldo. All right. Okay, several. For the rest of y'all, children's books. It's illustrated. You can get it from the library. I recommend it. It's a good book. Or there's a series of them. You open it up, and it's illustrated. It's kind of a cartoon. Lots of different things in the picture. But your job, or your kid's job, but we adults like to do it too, was to look through there, and you got to find in that picture that guy. He's wearing a white and red striped sweatshirt and hat, and he's got these black round glasses on. You got to find him. When you do it, you go, there's Waldo. And then you move on to the next page. Well, for me, that's kind of what we're doing in the Old Testament this summer. Where is Jesus in the Old Testament? Well, I mentioned earlier, he is very visible in the book of Proverbs. I said earlier, mostly written by King Solomon, but King Hezekiah, also one of the later godly kings of Judah, wrote chapters 25 to 29 of the book of Solomon, but the other 27 or so were written by probably King Solomon. And yes, it's a book of wise sayings. They're addressed oftentimes to my son. And so you could tell that Solomon was writing this book to his child, raising him up, knowing that one day this child of his was going to be the king. One of the things that Solomon did at the beginning of his reign is very important. God one night in a dream said to Solomon, and we read this a few weeks ago, Solomon, what do you want? I'll give it to you. Riches, fame, power. And Solomon thought, and he goes, no, you made me king of your people, Israel, and I have no idea how to lead them. What I want more than those other things, I want wisdom. Wisdom to lead your people. And God says, I love that. Absolutely, Solomon. And so God gifted him with wisdom. And he writes those down in the book, and so we kind of think they're just a book of wise sayings. But when you get into chapter 8, you get a glimpse that these wise sayings are much more than sentences, that they're actually a person, that wisdom has being to it. Verses 1 through 4, it says wisdom. And since wisdom, chokma, in the Hebrew is a feminine noun, like agua is in Spanish. Chokma is a female noun. And so in verses 1 through 4, she's personified as a woman. And you get the idea, she's standing in the streets, she's maybe up on a soapbox with a megaphone if it was modern, she's yelling out, come listen to me, I've got something to say. She's trying to get people's attention so they'll come and listen. And Solomon says, this is what wisdom is like this woman calling out. Then when you get to verse 22 through 31, wisdom begins to speak. And you heard, I'll highlight three sentences. Number one, the Lord possessed me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old. When he established the heavens, I was there. That's verse 27. And verse 30, I was beside him like a master workman. And so you start asking yourself, who is this wisdom that he was there at the beginning with God? Why is he speaking? Oftentimes in the Old Testament, some of these mysteries are later revealed in the New Testament. Now that you've seen Jesus, who is the Word of God, at the beginning, the Word created everything. That Word became flesh and dwelled among us. One of the things the New Testament makes clear is that this wisdom of God also is Jesus. He is the Word in the flesh. He is wisdom. And so John makes it clear in the beginning of his gospel. We read this every Christmas morning, the alternate Christmas story in our church. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. Without him was not anything made that was made. Very same thing that wisdom was saying in Proverbs chapter 8, that Jesus is actually wisdom personified. The Apostle Paul, in the beginning of his letter to the Corinthians, says Jesus is the power of God and he is the wisdom of God. And before we move on, I want to talk about that word chokmah for a minute. The Hebrew word wisdom, it's got a holistic meaning to it. It doesn't mean being smart. No, not at all. Chokmah in the Old Testament means this, wisdom. Mind that is in tune with God's word, And so it knows God's word. It's actually read the words. A mind that is in tune with God's word, and as a result, then their hands are engaged in good deeds, their mouth speaks truth, and they have a heart that leans on divine guidance. And if that doesn't sound exactly like Jesus personified, I don't know what does. Jesus knew God's word perfectly well. His hands always involved in good deeds. He loved his neighbor as himself. His mouth always spoke truth, as you're going to hear in the gospel today. And his heart leans on divine guidance. He regularly asks his Father what it is that he is to do next. And even when it is difficult, life-takingly difficult for him, Jesus will always lean on God's divine guidance instead of his own. That is wisdom personified. And so Christians, when we want to be wise, we want to be more than smart. We want whatever we know about the Word of God to come out in our actions, in our words, and that our lives would reflect divine guidance. That is who Jesus is defined. Let's move on to the gospel lesson today, which actually I started to realize there was another Where's Waldo moment found in the gospel reading, which I think should make sense, because Jesus, when he taught his disciples how the Old Testament was all about him, it's going to be obvious that he'll refer back to it then, to be teaching about him. Actually, Acts does the same thing. And I'm wondering how often this summer, as I open up a gospel lesson, that is going to have something to do with explaining the Old Testament. Sometimes you will hear people say that Jesus never called himself God, which means one of two things. Number one, they actually haven't read their Bible very well. You could even just read today's gospel lesson. Why did they want to throw rocks at Jesus? Because he claimed to be God. So when people say Jesus never called himself God, they haven't either read their Bibles very well, or maybe if it's the Jehovah Witnesses at your door, they're reading a Bible that has been badly translated. Here's one of their tricks. Jesus never said he was God, and you're sitting there like, oh, really? Tell me about that. And they said, well, John chapter 1, the words I just read. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. And you're like, oh, I thought my Bible says and the Word was God, and they'll say, nope, that's a bad translation. Well, it's not. Theirs is actually the bad translation. The Word was God comes straight out of the Greek. But to serve their ends, they have badly translated the Scriptures, and they'll often try to trip Christians up. And so if you have never read your Bible, you're willing to say, oh, doggone that, Pastor Scott's been lying to me for years. I didn't even know it. Well, they're not speaking truth there. Jesus constantly called himself God, and he also proved himself to be God. Jesus was so clear about this that they did try to throw rocks at him at the end of the lesson today for blasphemy, making oneself out to be either equal with God or, in Jesus' case, God's son. Either way, that's actually what will get him on the cross. The Pharisees, when Jesus was challenging them, he said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, if any of you keep my word, you will never see death. And to that, they throw their hands up in the air, and they're pretty sure that they've won. And they say, are you kidding us? Remember Abraham? He's our father. Abraham died. We know where his grave is. And what about all those prophets before you? Huh? Who do you make yourself out to be? They said to Jesus. And then instead of backing up there, Jesus continues to push on. He said, your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it, and he was glad. And of course, to that, they slapped their hands on their head, and you're saying, you're not even 50 years old. Are you kidding me? What do you mean that Abraham saw your day and that he was glad? It's thought here that Jesus is referring to Genesis chapter 22. What for Abraham in his story, as you think about that, was the moment where Abraham saw Jesus? Was it not after Abraham was 100 years old, Sarah was 90, they had a kid named Isaac, and when Isaac was 12 years old, God said, take Isaac and go and sacrifice him on this mountain that I will show you. And then Abraham loaded up everything, and they traveled for 3 days to Mount Moriah. Why did they travel 3 days to Mount Moriah? Because Mount Moriah would later become known as Jerusalem. On that mountain, Abraham, I want you to sacrifice your son. Abraham was obedient, tied his son up, laid him on the altar, and as he raised his knife, of course, God says, stop, wait, Abraham. And Abraham looked up, and over in the thicket was a ram. And God says, that's the substitute right there. And so on that day, Abraham sacrificed the substitute for the life of his son. Abraham was a prophet. Abraham knew that this story wasn't just some strange story about he and his son. This is a story about what God had promised to do for Abraham, to be a blessing through him. Abraham might not have known that that was Jesus, but he knew that that ram stuck in the bush was the substitute. And he knew what that ram stood for. And so when Jesus says, Abraham saw my day, he saw it and he was glad. This is what he was referring to. Truly, truly, I say to you, Jesus continues on, before Abraham even was, I am. And there's the kicker right there. In the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, when Moses visits the burning bush and he says, Lord, who shall I tell the Israelites is sending me? God gave Moses his personal name, which was I am. So when Jesus says, before Abraham even was, I am, he absolutely claimed to be God. Not just in his words, but then if you look at all of his actions. Before that, he had raised the dead, he'd opened blind eyes, unstopped deaf ears, made the mute to speak, made the lame to walk. All of these things proclaim Jesus' divinity. So today, on Holy Trinity Sunday, we won't fall for that thing that says Jesus never claimed to be God. He absolutely did in both his words and in his deeds. And then I want to end with our reading from the book of Acts, yet another Where's Waldo moment, as Peter is preaching his very first sermon. And I mentioned earlier that, of course, not only are they filled with the Holy Spirit, we read that story last week, 50 days after the resurrection, the Holy Spirit fell on Peter and the rest of his friends, so they were empowered. They were empowered, but they'd also been educated for those 40 days after the resurrection by Jesus. He'd explained the scriptures to them. Peter is now ready to preach. And this first sermon, he really lets it fly. And so as he's speaking to these Jews in Jerusalem who had gathered around, he says, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made this Jesus, both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you have crucified. Lord and Christ, Old Testament titles for the Messiah. By raising Jesus from the dead, Peter is saying, that proves that he is the one that we've been waiting for. And Peter makes that statement after showing the crowds how Jesus' resurrection was a fulfillment of several Old Testament passages, the two we quoted today, Psalm 16 and Psalm 110, both written by King David. So even as Peter's preaching, he's continually pointing back to the Old Testament because that's the scriptures of those people. They ought to know them. And he then argues that Jesus is the Messiah because he's done a great job of doing exactly what the Old Testament said that he would do. And on that day, with that apostolic preaching, that Holy Spirit-inspired preaching and knowledge of the Word of God, it said 3,000 souls were added to the church that day. 3,000 people had their eyes open to know that Jesus was the Messiah, that his death on the cross was for the forgiveness of their sins, that they'd been promised eternal life because Jesus was risen from the dead. One day they would be too. That is the power of apostolic preaching at its finest. 3,000 souls added to their numbers on that day. The Bible does clearly teach that God is the Father. We're going to confess this using the Nicene Creed in a moment. The Father Almighty, that Jesus is his only begotten Son, and that the Holy Spirit is divine and is to be worshipped and glorified together. As we've sat here this morning, much more than learning information, pray that this wisdom of God that we have heard today would give us a mind that is in tune with God's Spirit, would give us hands that are engaged in good things wherever it is we go this week, a mouth that speaks truth instead of lies, and that our hearts would always lean on the divine guidance of the Holy Scriptures. We're going to sing, you can't really have Holy Trinity Sunday, in my opinion, without singing number 165, the thrice holy, 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 holy Lord God Almighty. Why don't we stand if we're able?
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
The Nicene Creed is found on page 64, right next to our usual Apostles' Creed. The Nicene Creed was written a little later than the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed, people had started to find loopholes in some of the language for bad teaching. So the Nicene Creed is longer because it seeks, almost like a leaking dam, to fill in those cracks. We confess. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Majestic Trinity, we ask that you would grant your church wisdom and faithfulness. Guide her in your truth, that the mystery of your eternal presence may be proclaimed throughout the nations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Triune God, in these days when schools and Sunday schools have drawn to a close, be with students and instructors. We thank you for a good conclusion to the period of learning of last year, and we pray that this summer break would be a time of renewal and relaxation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we pray that you would inspire us and the nations to be better stewards of your creation. Instill in us such a sense of awe at the majesty of your creation that we do become more faithful caretakers of this earth and its resources. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And God of life, we pray that you would strengthen and sustain those who suffer this day, whether it be with things like depression or other mental things, whether it be physical. Bring comfort to those who are ill or are grieving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask these things this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Why don't you take a moment and share the peace with those around you. Continue with the offering prayer as printed in your bulletin. Benevolent God, you have granted us an abundance with all the good things that life has to offer. May we be truly grateful for our daily bread, even as we return a portion of what you have first given us as a sign of our humility and thanksgiving for your bounteous gifts. Let the treasures we have received from you be used to serve the world you love. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body. It's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Also with the cup of wine, he gave thanks and said, "Take and drink, this is the new covenant. My blood has been shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, remember us always in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus has prepared this table for us. You're welcome to it. Can have the deacons come forward.
You have fed,
nourished, and forgiven us at your holy table. Send us now into the world to share the good news of your salvation with all we need. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the name of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, put on love which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. And let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen. Closing hymn will be number 534. You can stand if you're able.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.